I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Welcome back to Thinking Critical. This is Wes. Here on the channel, we've had a few discussions lately kind of about like mentorship, where maybe some things have dropped off in the industry, as well as maybe a few controversies about fixing art and stuff like that. And I thought I would bring in comic book artist Eric Canete to kind of talk about his experiences with the industry, his thoughts on some of these controversies and other things about kind of what we're dealing with now. Eric, how you doing today?
I'm good, Wes. Thank you for having me.
Well, I'm glad that you could make it in here. We just had a conversation with Doc maybe two weeks ago. We were talking about the previous developments as far as mentorship and developing artists in the comic book industry. And one of the things we talk about, pretty much in length, it almost felt like it was the Jim Lee, like, love video, where we were just talking about Jim Lee's WildStorm studio, where how they were able to just develop all these great artists, your Brett Booth, J. Scott Campbell, some of the bigger names that came out of there. And I know you were a part of that, correct?
Near the tail end, yes. I was never in the studio with Brett. I was never in the studio with J. Scott Campbell. But yeah, I was there with Lee Bermejo, Carlos DeAnda, Ali Garza, and then Sandra Hope, Richard Friend, and Trevor Scott were also in the pits. And Dustin Nguyen, good friend Dustin Nguyen, we're all in the studio together.
It's crazy when you say those names, and I think about Lee Bermejo and his painted comic artwork, and I see your kind of super frenetic, cool edges and really awesome pose comic work. And then I think Dustin Nguyen, who's got more of a like exaggerated style, almost cartoonish, but not really, like completely different styles coming out of the same studio.
Yeah.
And it's pretty crazy to think that Jim Lee and WildStorm had a part to do with that. Now, what's cool about Jim Lee's WildStorm is he could have, with the name that he had and the recognition, he could have went out there and just got the biggest names to kind of come out on board with him. But it felt like he wanted to go and identify and bring in and develop the best talent possible.
Yeah, I think, this is just opinion. I wasn't in on the ground floor, obviously, and I don't have mind reading power, so I don't know exactly. But I remember when WildStorm, I think it's Jim's business acumen. He understood the style that sold, and it was part of it was his. And there was a version of the comic book industry that was really chasing the next version of Jim Lee, right? Like, he was the most marketable commodity, that style and that look.
I sold a comic book in American history.
There you go. So everybody understood that, right? So when Jim opened his studio, he knew part of the appeal is that he was going to have people who were sort of stylistically Jim Lee-centric. So he brought in a lot of those guys and helped cultivate them. Now, the great thing is that a lot of them sort of graduated and sort of matured into their own sort of powerhouses stylistically, right? But you can still see that the DNA, the hint of where they came from in as far as Jim Lee. So that, I think that's part of the decision making. And then eventually, and just the natural maturation of any sort of business, I would think, is that Jim understood good is good, and he would help mentor you regardless of what style you rocked, So it was great to have been part of that.
Yeah, it's crazy. You think about Brett Booth. Recently, he did those X-Men Legends comics with Bobby Nicienza.
Yeah.
And it looks like he's channeling his inner Jim Lee. Like, if you can't get Jim Lee to illustrate this comic book, Brett Booth is the next person.
Yeah, I don't want to diminish with the body of work that Brett has sort of like developed over the years since leaving WildStorm. If you take a look at what he was doing back then, especially just the line work and the ink work, he was distinct for that era. The stuff that he's doing now has a lot more of like developed flavor for the body of work that he's turned himself into.
Yeah, it's crazy. So he can do that like original, Jim Lee kind of style, but then you look at his flash forward, it's not the same thing.
Absolutely.
It's much more of a flash centric, everything's in motion, super kinetic,
for sure.
Wonderful details and, the big arms and all that stuff. And then you see him work on like Bloodshot, completely different type of superhero, more grounded, but kind of gritty. He's a varied artist. He can do a lot of different things. He's got a lot of tools in his toolbox. But he still can go back to that Jim Lee stuff that he learned
for sure. And I think this is just my sort of perspective, my analysis. You channel Jim Lee by channeling his influences, right? And somehow you arrive at what Jim has been able to do, right? So I don't know if he's immediately is it just a guess? I'm sure we could go talk to Brett and be like, hey, how do you do this? But it's like, you know, you can land in the general vicinity of Jim by sort of understanding where Jim is coming from. So I'm sure I think where people fail in copying Jim is that they go, okay, he's done X-Men and whatever, Hush and Superman, and they just go and copy. I think the better way to go is to understand where the DNA of where Jim's style has evolved from, and you can get even closer, right? And I'm not going to forget how much Scott Williams adds to all of that, because it's also Scott's style and his inking work that you sort of take away as well and incorporate.
Yeah, it's crazy. The lack of inkers is really detracted, you know, kind of from the overall flavor of some of the art. Sure. It just adds so much to it when you get that great inker on it. They work together seamlessly.
I know in the time that I was in studio and the opportunities that I was able to sit down with Scott Williams, he is also in that mentorship mind space, or at least he was when I was there. I don't know what it was like when they were in full production during the highest of the hype, right? But when I was there, Scott was always available to be able to talk to in regards to how making craft better. Between him and just natural teachers, him, Jim, and Wills were also really, really good people to be able to tap on the shoulder and say, hey, how do I do this? Where can I get better?
I know Will still does that. You know, obviously I live in the Philippines and they have some Comic Cons, and he's always one of the main people in there, and he kind of huddles up and he's always trying to mentor the artist.
Absolutely.
Kind of develop the talent here.
Absolutely.
So how did they discover a young Eric Canete that, you know, had you already produced some work? Was it some indie comics or
I had
did they
some,
do a talent search?
Yeah, it's a pretty funny story. Dustin was the guy that they really wanted. Dustin Nguyen, my very, very good friend. They saw him. They saw the potential behind him. They were doing sort of it's not a tryout book, but certainly it was a book that they wanted to take their audience's temperature. It was called Gen Active. And Dustin had done a book for a series for them called Jet. And they really loved the way the stuff that he was producing. It was sort of a mix of whatever influences they had and also what Travis was doing at the time, Travis Shure. And they loved Dustin. And I was in there and I took drives into La Jolla from Los Angeles with him. And at that point, I really wanted to be in that studio and be a full-time sort of, you know, member of the WildStorm team. I don't think I was as viable as Dustin was stylistically, right? But I think the story goes, and I credit him for my tenure there. Dustin convinced them, hey, give him a shot. Right? Like, he's a good friend of mine or whatever it is. I don't know if it's true, but they ultimately did. And that's how I got in there and sort of, you know, snuck in and earned my seat as I went.
So did they throw you right on the authority, or, you know, how did they develop you as a talent within that studio?
Yeah, it was really, you know, at that point, I believe that I had enough notches on my belt because I had been working professionally in the animation industry. So they were a bit more hands off with me, right? But, you know, they gave me, I was working on Cybernary 2.0 at that time. That was the big script that I had, and I poured myself into that. And I think that was right around the time that Jim was working on Hush. I think those were the pages that was. So can you imagine? Jim had his own corner office in La Jolla, but he never worked in it. That was more like the administrator Jim office. He really loved being in the pit because I felt like the energy that he needed in order to get Hush done, to keep working as an artist, he pulled it from a lot of the artists around him. So he immersed himself in that pit with us. And that was really super encouraging and oftentimes intimidating. But Jim was a resource always, right? So if you were asking about how I helped myself to develop, it was because I was surrounded by a lot of different artists, you know, not the least of which inkers and Sandra Hope and Richard Friend and Trevor Scott, but also Ollie was there. And there's just that natural, healthy competition to be in that space, to be able to look over somebody's shoulder and go like, what are you doing? And then obviously the lunch and after hours conversations that you have with these artists and the kind of stuff that they were looking at.
It's gotta be intimidating when you have a piece of art. It's like, it's time to show it to Jim, or Jim sees it and he wants to talk to you about it. Is this good? Oh my
goodness. Yeah, no. I remember, what was I was doing something in Cybernary, and Jim goes, did you ever think about like painting this whole thing? And I said, no, I'm already slow enough. There's no way I'm going to be able to paint this. And he's like, great. That's great. You know, it's self-awareness on your part. That's awesome. You know, and the few times that he would look over my pages, he'd say things like, you know, you need to glam this shot up. It's a main shot of Cybernary. You're doing this upshot on her that doesn't really help to sort of to highlight her features as a beautiful figure, as a beautiful face. If you just change the angle a little bit, I bet you this would go a whole, you know, this would go a lot further to selling the overall beauty of this character. And I still remember that to this day, because I go for these dramatic shots that don't necessarily help to highlight what he's talking about. So I switched it up a little bit, and he's like, oh, that makes a lot of sense. That was really super helpful for Jim. That's years of experience being distilled to a 5-minute conversation. You know what I mean?
You can see it in your art today. What do you, yeah, when you're putting out your shots on Twitter or on your website or on YouTube, I can see one of your focuses is always, I want the main character to look as cool as humanly possible.
Absolutely.
If this is what I'm doing, he needs to look badass. And now that I know where that comes from, it makes sense.
That's the underlying thing, I think, if I've learned, picked up either directly or indirectly from Jim, is that learn to choose the moments that you really want to highlight and give them make it as bombastic and big as possible. I think there's times for those super wide shots with like a little tiny character, but when it's like a big moment, you really want to help highlight that. And Jim does that, I think, almost to absolute perfection.
Oh, yeah. So yeah. Reason is one of the greatest, you know, not just interior, but cover artists of all time.
Absolutely.
So, you know, just kind of getting into your time there at WildStorm, obviously you're being developed and everything. And one of the things that we've mentioned a few times here is that the lack of these studios or these groups of people of talents getting together and like elevating themselves as they're all producing work together. It feels like the craft of visual storytelling, there's something missing there. Is that something that Jim and some of the other mentors there would have like been honing? Like, if you're trying to get to here to here to here, this is the sequencing, or these are the things that you need to highlight to make this look as engaging as possible.
I don't know if it was that level of hand-holding, right? But there's definitely an emphasis on what makes for, at least within the context of the studio, the type of storytelling that they appreciate there. Does that make sense? So similar to Marvel, and this isn't what do you call it, WildStorm exclusive, but I think one of the key things is having somebody in a position that understands the things that you want to help highlight for that brand. So the way they tell, you know, back then there were like three different studios that were really the premier people, were like, you know, Jim Lee at WildStorm, Mark Silvestri at Top Cow, Rob Liefeld at Extreme. They had their brand of storytelling. They had their way of storytelling. So similar to that, Marvel would as well. Historically, there's been an art director in place.
The Marvel way.
Exactly. To help highlight and make sure that there is a through line to how they told stories. A lot of that is gone now. You know, there's not as much emphasis on this is how we tell stories here. So I'm thinking, unless it's an artist that is really cued in to how to tell great storytelling, immersive storytelling, panel, like really clear panel to panel, you know, Marvel style storytelling. A lot of it is just sort of like, you know, you pick it up by osmosis and you're not really doing it correctly. You know, there really needs to be somebody to help you understand why you pick those shots, why these characters are drawn a specific way. And Jim helped to highlight all of that, you know, naturally trending towards what his studio, the look for his studio was. I understood that.
Yeah, so you're talking like maybe an art director.
Yes.
That comes through and says, this doesn't exactly fit the type of storytelling we do in this studio.
Correct.
We're going to need these changes. But I agree. There's almost not even like a house art style. Like it used to be like, this is kind of what DC Comics looks like. And
this is what
a Marvel comic looks like.
This isn't a conversation about house style, right? I'm not a huge proponent of that. I'm talking about understanding your brand, understanding your IP, understanding what got you there and saying like, we need to continue to do this type of storytelling. Right. Whether it's a big type of storytelling where it's like everybody's fighting, you know, the big summer events as I'd grown accustomed to, or like even just, you know, I read everything from Daredevil back when John Romita Jr. was doing it to like Jim Lee doing X-Men. So those are two very different types of books visually, But in as far as the way they told their stories, it was clear and very concise, right? And I don't know if there's somebody in that space that represents mm-hmm. the art director that makes them go like, okay, I understand Daredevil and it kind of needs to look like this. I also understand X-Men and it kind of looks like this, you know?
So is there any way that you could recreate what you got in the studio where you're sitting next to these up-and-coming talents, these legends or whatever, and everyone's improving? It feels like we're all connected, because of the internet, but that allows us to all be disconnected and not have to be near each other.
Yeah.
And I imagine that has a lot to do with maybe some of the loss of craft is you're not sitting there next to somebody learning. Like, can you do that on a Zoom call?
You can. I mean, that technology, I would think, is so much more available to you than it was back in the day. I really believe, and this was when there was more of a portfolio review process in regards to breaking into the industry. A good portion of it is in the vetting, of the artists that are going to be coming in. A lot of in my time trying to get work in comics, I dealt with people like Mark Chiarella, who was actually an art director, right? So when he's looking through my pages, he has the DNA, and more importantly, like the understanding of what makes for good storytelling. So when he calls out stuff to me, right, like, hey, this panel doesn't make sense because it doesn't lead into this next panel, blah, 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 that kind of thing, right? Like, I don't know if that's there anymore. I can't be sure. I don't know if there's somebody who actually has the pedigree, the know-how, and the artistic, acumen, right, to understand this is how you tell good panel-to-panel storytelling. I don't know if there's that person. I remember bringing that up once in a conversation with someone, and I said, how is it that an editor that doesn't have the same sort of comic book art storytelling history is able to tell me, from an artistic perspective, which of these thumbnails to pick, right? Do they have understanding of composition? Do they have understanding of character development, or how I pose my character to emote the best way possible, right? Like, I don't know if they have, like I said, the training to be able to do that. And that was almost taboo to talk about, because you're shining a light on editors who may or may not have that skill set. But I think that's integral to be in that position.
Sean Gordon Murphy got in a little bit of trouble maybe like a year and a half ago when someone asked him, what do you want from an editor?
Sure.
And he says, I want somebody that's written a comic book and has a clear understanding of a three-act story structure.
Sure.
And that was, and I think he also wanted some type of literature degree. That was, people got mad at him. Why? How could you say that? Because there were editors at DC Comics that didn't have any of that.
Oh, I see. So it came from a defensive perspective, right? Like, hey,
yes, I don't qualify. You must be criticizing me. And when he was specifically just saying, these are the things that I think are like minimum requirements to be an editor in comic books. And people were upset.
I don't see anything wrong with that.
No.
For me, you need to have the understanding of basic story structure.
He's right? one of the most successful creators in comics. He knows what he needs to be successful.
For sure. And the question was pointed directly to him to say, hey, what do you think you would want from an editor? And he gave his opinion about it. And just because it doesn't fit the box, like if I'm an editor and I don't happen to fulfill those things that Sean Gordon Murphy wants, it shouldn't diminish me as a concept, right? It just shows how thin your skin is for that kind of criticism, that's a Sean Gordon Murphyism. That's fine, but it's not, I don't disagree with him, right? You should have an understanding of how story structure works.
Absolutely. How are you going to support him if you don't know what he's building?
Yeah. How can you possibly give, how can you like that sort of skill set? It doesn't mean that you're going to tell Sean Gordon Murphy to wholesale change things. All that means is that you hold him accountable. If he sets something up in Act 1, right, he has to have thematically a through line through Act 2 and Act 3. Story structure just helps you hold your artists and storytellers accountable to the thing that they set up. It doesn't mean you have to have a masterful understanding of it, right? It just means you have to have an understanding of it. I don't understand what people's problems are.
That's what editors are. They're support to make sure that you build the house correctly. Correct. It's your house. They're just going, it all makes sense.
That's some of the most healthiest relationships that I've had in regards to having editors in place. Working in the animation industry, there's always a story editor in the production process, right? and they make sure as best as they can before that it gets to me, before I start doing storyboards for, that some of those editorial calls are especially when it comes to character consistency in characters, right? Not just shot by shot, but obviously motivations. Those things need to be in place.
Absolutely. Here's another theory that I've had with comic books, that Jim Lee, or the current state of the industry, that Jim Lee, Rob Liefeld, Mark Zavelsky, the Image Seven, when they left, I think Marvel and, to a lesser degree, DC Comics are scared out of their minds of developing and creating the next, A-list superstar comic book artist, where they get, these really great runs on an X-Men or a Spider-Man, to where their name becomes so big that they're selling comic books, not because, certainly Spider-Man or Marvel on the title helps, but their name boosts it to another level, like a Jim Lee would have done, like a Todd McFarlane did, like a Rob Liefeld did. Yeah. And so I think that also might be a part of what you're talking about, where people aren't getting those big long runs and getting lots of success and really developing and honing their talent, because they're being popped around from title to title, character to character, maybe two issues here, one issue here, maybe a six-issue story here. Mm-hmm. And then once you kind of have a name, you're just a cover artist, or you come in and you pop numbers for the first two issues on a debut, and then you're on to the next project that you're supporting.
That sounds awful. maybe I'm naively optimistic, but I hope that's not the case. Although, I don't know. I've listened to a handful of podcasts from the creators of that era. There's a lot of backroom shenanigans that happen where I'm like, wow, people are so petty sometimes. You guys are making freaking comic books, you know? But to my attitude is at least my perspective on why artists don't stick around. I know that sometimes you get to a point in your artistic craft leveling up where you can't keep up with a monthly schedule. But certainly I would hope that they would, give you enough of a lead time. An artist, or sometimes I can speak for myself, I burn through lead time like you wouldn't believe, right? So I'm not very responsible for my time. So there's different cases, but in the scenario that you set up, I really hope it's not because they believe that these guys are going to, transcend the X title, and they in and of themselves become an industry, and now they're going to go leave and do, because they're going to end up doing that anyway. So why not take advantage of the time when you have them?